chapter 4. Why start at the beginning when you could start at chapter 4? In Aldous Huxley's dystopia, Brave New World, there were 5 castes. The alphas and betas were allowed to develop normally. The gammas, deltas, and epsilons were treated with chemicals to arrest their development intellectually and physically. The result? A neatly stratified society with intellectual function and physical development correlated with caste. That was satire, wasn't it? No relation with real life. We would never, surely, tolerate a state of affairs that stratified people, then made it harder for the lower orders, but helped the higher orders to reach their full potential. Were we to find a chemical in the water or in food that was damaging children's growth and their brains worldwide, and thus their intellectual development and control of emotions, we would clamor for immediate action. Remove the chemical and allow all our children to flourish. Stop the injustice now. Yet, unwittingly perhaps, we do tolerate such a state of affairs. The chemical is called social disadvantage. It tracks the social hierarchy, and it limits the potential of children, stops them developing intellectually, socially, emotionally, and behaviorally, and has catastrophic effects on what happens in the rest of their lives. And we see it in all sorts of ways. I was in the US earlier this year and about to give a lecture, and I found that I couldn't start my lecture without talking about what happened in Baltimore. And you'll remember the precipitant for the eruption of Baltimore was the killing of a black man in police custody. That was the precipitant, but it wasn't the cause. The cause was inequality. I went to a meeting at that School of Public Health in Baltimore. I thought he was mayor of New York, wasn't he?
Yeah,
and a couple of young doctors said to me, you can't just sit here in what's his name, School of Public Health. We've got to show you Baltimore. So they took me around, and we started in Roland Park. Leafy area, beautiful manicured lawns. And then we went to the Upton Druid area. Every second house had a diagonal red cross on the door. The house had been condemned. The emergency services would not go in the event of fire or other emergency. Young men hanging around on street corners. It wasn't Baltimore that erupted. It was the Upton Druid Heights neighborhood in Baltimore that erupted. And life expectancy in Upton Druid is 63, in Roland Park is 83. When we had the riots in London in the summer of 2011, they broke out in Tottenham. If you know London, they didn't break out outside Harrods in Knightsbridge. They broke out in Tottenham. I'd been showing data showing that Tottenham had the lowest male life expectancy in London, 20 years shorter than the best of. What a coincidence that the riots broke out in the area with worse health. I don't think riots cause ill health, and I don't think ill health causes riots. But social disadvantage, beginning right at the beginning of life, as in Aldous Huxley's dystopia, leads to ill health and leads to urban unrest. A typical resident, I'll call him LeSean, in Upton Druid. Half the families were single parent families, median household income, $17,000, doing poorly in reading, missing school, 90% did not go on to college. Each year, a third, aged 10 to 17, arrested for juvenile disorder each year. By the age of 17, the chance of surviving without some kind of arrest puts you in a minority. And you know what a catastrophic effect that has for the rest of that young man's life. 100 non-fatal shootings for every 10,000 residents and nearly 40 homicides. Roland Park, 93% two-parent families, median income not 17, but $90,000, 97% good reading, very few missing schools, 75% completed college, as distinct from 90% did not go on to college. And in Roland Park, they stay out of the clutches, both of the gangs and the police. No non-fatal shootings. The homicide rate was 1/10. And the life expectancy gap is 20 years. Now, when you think about what I call health inequities, the unfair inequalities in health, it's common to think of poor health for the poor. And indeed, the poor do have poor health, as I've just shown you from the poor part of Baltimore. I could have shown you the same from New York or Washington, D.C. But that's only part of the story. Health follows a social gradient. We've got life expectancy at birth for men and women. I think, Jack, you were a co-author of this paper, weren't you? The Olshansky paper. So you probably thought, when all this fuss in the last week about white men, and you said, hang on a minute, we published that in 2012. So it wasn't news to you, it wasn't news to me either. I've written about it in my book and published
your... If you had won the Nobel Prize the month previously.
It may have had something to do with it. But anyway, Dr. Rowe was a co-author of this paper with Olshansky, showing the gradient by years of education. The more years of education, the longer the life expectancy for white men, white women, white men, black men. And the particular group that Olshansky, Rowe et al. Drew attention to, and as did Anne Case and Angus Deaton, was white men with low education. And in fact, in that paper that got so much attention, the rise in mortality for US whites, this is from the Case and Deaton paper, when you look by education, the lower the education, the steeper the rise in mortality. It's a gradient. Now, the implications of the gradient are quite profound. I've had Americans say to me, well, yeah, you know, the poor. I don't have a strong enough stomach to listen to the debates last night, but one attitude to the poor is the poor are the architects of them. Own misfortune, they're to blame, they're feckless, they're irresponsible, welfare dependent, and the like. You've heard it all. Or, I'm sure in this August School of Public Health, you may think that poverty is a stain on a civilized society, but whether you're of that persuasion or this persuasion, you think it's the poor, it's not me. The average person thinks, I'm not involved in this story. And my message is, you are involved. This story involves all of us, you and me, because it's a gradient. Figure one from the health gap, stop plugging your book, it's terribly bad, very bad form. I was asked on the BBC when we published it, I'd been going through all the explanations of all the different things through the life course, early child development, education, all the things you've got to do. And then the interviewer said, what's the one thing you would recommend? And I'd just gone through all the different things. What's the one thing you would recommend? I said, one thing? Read my book. And she said, that was quite charming. He was so brazen. It was. This is life expectancy. Each dot represents a small area of England classified by income deprivation. So we've got the most affluent up here. People near the top have shorter life expectancy than those at the top. People in the middle, shorter life expectancy than those near the top. It's a gradient. And this is disability-free life expectancy. It's a steeper gradient. And in fact, we calculated for England that for people in the middle, on average, have eight fewer years of healthy life. Eight fewer years of healthy life means earlier onset of decline in grip strength, of difficulties with mobility, of decline in cognitive function, and of course, fewer years of life. We calculated that if everybody in England had the low mortality of the top 10%, there would be 200,000 fewer deaths each year, 500 a day. Think about the US population. The same figures apply, probably do. That five times that is 1 million fewer deaths every year if everybody had the same low mortality as the top 10%. And the tragedy of it is we think we know what to do. And we have to get those rascals to listen. To make the point about the average, you're a 15-year-old boy in the US. Count 100 people like you. 13 of you will fail to reach your 60th birthday. Is 13 out of 100 a lot? Well, it's double the Swedish figure. It's higher than Costa Rica and Cuba and Chile, and it's about the same as Georgia. I don't mean Georgia, I mean Georgia. In fact, there's 194 member states of the world. I hope you got that about Georgia, by the way, right? I don't do that accent very well. There are 194 member states of the World Health Organization, and the US ranks 50th on this metric. Not doing very well. And it's not a medical care issue. Think about the Case-Deaton paper. What did those men die of? They died of alcohol and drug-related poisonings. They died of suicide. They died of alcohol-related chronic liver disease. And they died of external causes of death. That's not a medical care issue. That relates to society, and it's affecting everybody. The implication of the gradient is we have to take action to improve society, not only to relieve poverty. And there's a great deal we can do. And it starts at the beginning of life, give every child the best start in life. Look at these figures. This comes from the 1970 British birth cohort study. Look at children who, at 22 months of age, it's following children from 22 months to 10 years, children who at 22 months of age were in the 10th centile of cognitive development. If they grow up in families of low socioeconomic status, follow them to 10 years of age, they remain low. There's regression to the mean, but Dr. O will explain that afterwards. If they grew up in families of high socioeconomic status, they catch up. Now look at the children who, at 22 months of age, were in the 90th centile of cognitive development. If they grow up in families of high socioeconomic status, they remain high. In low socioeconomic status, their ranking declines. Assume for the moment that all the differences at 22 months are biologically determined, and the differences associated with the socioeconomic status of the family are social. The social trumps the biological. Now, not all the differences at 22 months are biological. Quality of early caring and rearing matters, but it shows quite how vital. And whether it's in Glasgow or in Baltimore, It starts at the beginning of life with the quality of what happens in the early years. And we've been monitoring this in England, looking at readiness for school by age five. And I know Mr. Bertolini's going to talk about income, so I wanted to introduce his topic. And what it shows for local authorities, the more affluent the local authority, the higher the proportion of children age five classified as ready for school. I showed this graph at the House of Commons, the British Parliament, and some joker in the audience, not an MP, said, the multiple R squared of that correlation is quite low. And I thought that's what MPs most want to discuss, proportion of variance explained. I said, what that gentleman means is that there's variation around the line. And what that suggests is two strategies. One is reduce deprivation. Give people more money, and you'll improve early child development. And the other is, given that for a given level of deprivation, some are doing better than others, intervene to break the link between deprivation and early child development. And we know a great deal about how to do that. Parenting, supporting parents, services. So can you reduce deprivation? Well, some countries know how to do that. This is the child poverty defined as less than 60% of median income, before and after taxes and transfers. So in Latvia, pre-tax and transfer, child poverty was 35%, in Sweden, 32%. After taxes and transfers, child poverty goes down to 25% in Latvia, it goes down to 12% in Sweden, even lower in Slovenia. The Swedes and the Slovenians are intolerant of child poverty. So they use the fiscal system to reduce it. The Latvians don't do that. What about Americans? Worse than Latvia. What on earth are you doing? Why do you think child poverty is such a good thing? A lot of money sloshing about. You just don't use it to relieve child poverty. We're not great in the UK, but you make us look terrific. Thank you for that. And one of the problems is what happens in this generation affects the next generation. Forget this gobbledygook up here, that's economist language. What it means is the correlation between parents' income and the income of adult children for countries. So if rich parents had rich children, poor parents had poor children, and intermediate parents had intermediate children, in other words, no social mobility, parents' income determined child's income, a country would score one on this metric. If there was no relation between parents' income and children's income, in other words, a great deal of social mobility, a country would score zero. So Denmark, Norway, Finland have a great deal of social mobility. The US and the UK, a great deal less. And the problem is that this is correlated with the Gini coefficient of income inequality. The higher the Gini, the higher the income inequality of this generation, the less mobility. In other words, the greater the distance between the rungs of the ladder, the more difficulty for the next generation to get from one rung to the next. There's probably not a politician in the land who would stand up in public and say he or she was against equality of opportunity. The problem is the playing field is very steeply tilted. And that inequality of opportunity relates to the inequality in this generation. Part of the legitimacy of a democratic society is that everybody has a chance. And it just ain't fair if my kids don't have a chance. Education. I'll skip over it because I want to hear the next speaker. fair employment and good work. One example, psychosocial stress and occupational class, effort reward imbalance, low control. For countries across Europe, 11 European countries, the higher the status, the less likely are people to have low control at work, disempowerment, and imbalance between effort and reward. So stress at work really matters. But we also go to work for something else, money. And introducing the next speaker. I said earlier that some people think the poor are the architects of their own misfortune. We've had the unfortunate language in Britain of strivers and shirkers. If you're poor, you must be a shirker. You don't like to work. And if you're not poor, you're a striver. The problem is that language is contradicted by the evidence. It doesn't slow them up any, but these are households where at least one adult is working. There are more households in poverty where at least one adult is working than workless households. The reason that these households are in poverty is not because they're feckless or morally irresponsible. It's because they're lowly paid. It's low pay that's leading to poverty, not moral worthlessness. And look at this, the risk in, these are British data, the risk of being below a minimum income standard in 2008-09, 31% of households with children were below the minimum income, and 2012-13, 39% were. In a rich country. And of course, what's happened is the pensioners have done well. It is a coincidence that the pensioners are more likely to vote than the families with children. And when they vote, they're more likely to vote Conservative. And they've done very well, and families with young children have done very poorly. And we can do something about unemployment as well. We worry about being neat, not in employment, education, or training, young people. In these areas of Swansea and Wrexham, two towns in Wales, they went into schools to identify young people they thought were at risk of becoming NEET, not in employment, education, or training, and worked with them. This is what happened to NEET in the whole of Wales. And the two areas where they intervened, starting here, they got a drop in youth unemployment. And an unexpected and unintended consequence of this program was they got a drop in youth crime. Surprise, surprise, when young people have got something to do, they don't get up to mischief. Ensure a healthy standard of living. I've got shocking news for you. Welfare spending improves health and reduces inequality. This is a measure of relative inequalities in health, primary versus tertiary education for women, and looking at countries, the generosity of their social expenditure. The more generous their social expenditure, the lower the health inequalities. Where did it get into the consciousness that welfare spending is a bad thing? Welfare spending is a mark of a civilized, caring society. And surprise, surprise, the more generous the country's welfare spending, the lower the health inequalities. Now, you could give this graph to a class of graduate students and they could spend a whole term discussing causation. This is from UNDP. Looks at a log of public expenditure on health care and education in 2000 and the Human Development Index 12 years later, and the HDI includes literacy, gross national income, and life expectancy. one of the many explanations for this correlation is if yours is the kind of country that spends on education and healthcare, is a caring society, yours is the kind of country that's going to have better human development. Let me finish with a rant. It's come to my attention very late in my life. There's some young people here. Cover up your ears, because I don't want you to hear this. It's come to my attention very late in my life that sometimes people in public life don't tell the truth. This is really shocking. You know, the Archbishop says, I didn't do it, and the next day he's gone. And the cabinet minister said, no, I didn't ask my wife to pretend she was driving the speeding car, and then he's found guilty. And well, we're being told in Britain that our economy is the envy of the developed world. We got the best economy. Everybody's lusting to be like we are. Well, this is the average real wage index for the G20 countries, and there's the United Kingdom. 2007 was 100. And we're down there. The US is about level pegging, not doing brilliantly, but we're down at 93. And the reason I'm having this rant is that I don't know how to change the political process, but I do know about evidence. And this is really naive now, but I'd like evidence to be part of the discussion about how we're going to improve health and promote health equity. And in a prestigious university like this one, that's your role in life. The last thing I want to say is that all countries have socioeconomic inequalities. And if health follows the social gradient, maybe health inequalities are inevitable. Well, this is life expectancy at 50. By level of education. ISCED 5 to 6 is tertiary education, and this is primary. SE is Sweden. We've got 15 countries here. Sweden has the longest life expectancy for men and women at 50, and a narrow gap between those with primary education and those with tertiary education. Hungary, Estonia, Bulgaria, Romania, Poland have lower average and a big gap, a steep gradient. So that the slope of the gradient can vary enormously. There are all countries of socioeconomic inequalities, but the magnitude of the socioeconomic inequalities in health varies enormously. Another way of saying it is that the variation among those with university education, the country variation, is a great deal less than the variation with those with only primary education. They do know how to get good health in Hungary and Estonia. People with university education enjoy it. But the more disadvantaged you are, the worse the health. When we launched the Commission on Social Determinants of Health, I quoted the poet Pablo Neruda and said, "Rise up with me against the organization of misery." I wanted to call my book The Organization of Misery, but the publisher wouldn't let me. It's The Health Gap. But I still invite you to rise up with me against the organization of misery.